Hi guys, I'm so sorry I'm late today. I got so excited about my guest today that I've had him talking for ages and I totally forgot to go live. So those of you that have been waiting, I do hope that you're still around. I am thrilled that my guest today is Pastor Michael Bassett, Reverend Dr. Michael Bassett even. He's a good friend of mine. He's an amazing minister, an amazing man of God, and I'm not going to wait any longer. I'm going to bring him on straight away and introduce him to you. Michael, good to see you. I am so thrilled. You know, we go back a long, long way.
Yeah, we do.
I mean, we go back to the 80s.
Yeah.
And you were the first person to invite me to come on staff as a pastor. Mm-hmm. And I remember that people used to visit us in church. They'd come over from America because, you know, your church, our church was the only show in town, really, at the time. You know, I mean, people came in from America that came to Victory Church, and that was it. Everyone came to Victory Church. Our Sunday nights were just, you know, they were always guest ministers, but all the guest ministers always used to try and marry me off to one of the pastors, usually Mark, because he was the only other white one. And they try and make me into a wife off, because it was kind of still unusual for a woman to be a pastor in her own right in those days. And so, you know, I'll be forever grateful to you for that, forever grateful that you enabled me to begin my ministry at Victory Church in London. And it was a tremendous ride, and I learned a great deal about what to do and what not to do. But guys, Pastor Michael and I were talking before, and I said to him, I have got so many things I want him to talk about that there is no way we can get it all done in one program. We're going to have him come again. And I got so carried away listening to him, I forgot to go live. See, you don't have to be smart to have a TV show. So I'm going to get him going now. I'm going to ask him. I've got so many things. I've got a list as long as my arm of things I want him to talk about. But I want him to go back to the very beginning, because his story starts really in the 60s in London. I guess it starts before that. It starts in childhood in South Africa. But, you know, the hook of the story, if you like, is in London. So, Michael, please tell us from the beginning your journey to Jesus. Go for it.
Okay, now you remember I have been talking already for 40 minutes and it wasn't recorded.
So yeah, but that's all right. You can go.
A short version. We'll break it up, Jen. I'll take you first of all on London side, then we'll stop when I went to America. I won't do America, I'll just do the London.
Well, we might do. Just depends. Carry on.
Now then we can do another time. We'll do a series. Okay. Well, anyway, my name is Michael Bassett. I'm 80 years of age. I've lived through, born 1942, so I was born during the war. So I lived as a young child in the 40s, and then I lived in the 50s in South Africa as a young boy, 60s in London as a young man, 70s in Los Angeles, 80s back in London, 90s in London and the south of France, and now we're in the 2000s. So I've had quite a colorful life. I've lived a long life. God's been good to me. But I'll just share a little bit from the beginning, because it's all pretty cool when you think about it. You know, everything is based upon numbers. All the prophetic words, everything that we have is all based upon timelines and just interesting things. You can do your own type of understandings about who you are through just the time you was born, the year you was born. I was born in 1942, on the 6th of August. Now, 6th of August is when they dropped the atom bomb on Hiroshima. But that was 1945. So, but 1942, I was born. 1945, they dropped the bomb on the day I was born. So I tell people, you know, that I don't know, but I just always seem to like to drop bombs. Not the truth bombs. But when I was a kid, right in the war, I remember our house had a direct hit from a German bomb, or V2 or something. And my dad, a very smart man he was, he built a cellar in the front lawn. And he put a lot of effort into it, to the point where apparently I heard from my sister that the neighbors sort of laughed at him because he is putting so much construction into this bunker. Well, anyway, because he did that, I'm alive today because we had a direct hit. And my mother got shrapnel all over her back. I remember that growing up. And we survived it. So as a young boy, I remember I used to love to play with train sets or toys that I'd get. And I'd always bomb them. I'd always be dropping bombs on the train or whatever, because I lived through the war. You know, the air raid shelters and all that sort of noise. And that was just how I was. That's how I was brought up. Well, 1948, my dad was a fireman in London. I remember as a young boy, one day, this big red fire truck stopped outside of our house. And I remember opened the front door and there was my dad. He was driving this truck with a big helmet on. Very impressed I was as a young boy. And my dad was putting out the fires in London. It was an inferno. Very dangerous job, also pulling out a lot of dead bodies. He never really spoke about it when I grew up. He never mentioned hardly anything about the war, in fact. But it must have been very, very difficult, very hard and challenging to see all the death everywhere, like we are experiencing now in the Ukraine, and also in Turkey, all the dead bodies everywhere. Well, that's how London was. It was a mess. Well, 1948, my dad decided that we as a family, he never asked me my opinion, of course. I was 6 years of age. He said, we're going to leave for another land. And he told me that this land had lions and tigers and all these animals. And my eyes were wide open. Wow, we're going to go on a plane. Well, what he emigrated, basically, the family to South Africa. And I remember us as a family in this country that none of us ever been to before. We didn't know anything. We were Englishmen, English people who wore the wrong clothes, didn't know anything about the culture or the foods. I remember when we first had a thing called corn on the cob. They'd call it mealies in those days. Mealies, that was the staple. And you get the mealie and you pull off the skin. We didn't cook it, we didn't know what to do. We ate it raw. That's we never saw one like that before. Remember, during the war, you didn't have fruit or anything. I think a banana, I had one now and again. And then we're eating all these strange exotic foods. And gradually we became very much part of the culture. And my dad was a very smart man. And he got into the real estate business. By the time before his death, he was very rich, had owned blocks of flats. He was a builder as well, built tons of homes. Very clever man. So I was raised on the beaches of Clifton. And if you know anything about South Africa or Cape Town, that's the best place to be. I mean, it's amazing. Now there are millions of pounds homes. But we were there, there was just shacks. And my dad bought one of these little shacks. Can you imagine? We'd love to have it now. Right on the beach. And life was good. I loved it. My sister Barbara, she's 3 years older than me. We'd run on the beach flying kites. And then I got to learn how to swim and get in the water. I mean, we had a lovely background. I was blessed. And then my dad sold that and bought another house because now he's into real estate. So we moved around a lot. we didn't stay too long in the house, he'd make a profit and buy another one. But that's where I grew up. And I went to school in South Africa. I went to Christian Brothers College as a young boy. Was there for quite a few years, but I was no good with school. I didn't like school at all. School didn't actually like me. And I was always in trouble. I was playing truant and going out with the wrong crowd and always had the wrong hairstyle for the Catholic brothers. They just really didn't get on with me. Well, what they did do right at the end, they expelled me. They expelled me in front of about 600 to 800 boys. And then the one brother slapped me across the face in front of everybody. It was, a big ground there at the school where we'd do all the cadets marching up and down and whatnot. So about 600 boys. And he told everybody, this is the vilest boy in the school, and slapped me and expelled me. Well, my dad didn't think that was too cool. And then my mother, she thought that, the earth had opened up. Her boy is expelled. But I thought he was going to be a doctor. He was going to be a clever young man. Well, I wasn't. I was useless. In fact, the only thing I got any good marks for was for scripture reading. That's the only thing I got any good marks. I failed everything. I was useless. And so my dad got me into another school in Seapoint, called Seapoint Boys High. And he managed to enroll me. Well, what he didn't know is that during the holiday between the two, this school and that school, there was a 6 weeks holiday. And during those 6 weeks, I was in the bar with few of my friends, and we'd just drink beer and play snooker and smoke cigarettes. They didn't go out to the beach, and we were just, big time now snooker players. And there was one gentleman there who we got very friendly with, and he took to us. He liked to hang around us, and we'd play snooker with him, and he'd drink a few beers and have a few cigarettes. And so anyway, I went to my new school on the first day, and I sat at the back row, my new uniform on. Between Serge DePinto and Mike Savage, these were the two bad boys, and I was in the middle. I went straight for the bad boys at the back of the class, and then the new teacher comes in, and guess what? It was the guy we were playing snooker with during the 6 weeks of school holiday, and he looked around the room, saw me, and he sort of went white, and he turned around and walked out the room. And about half an hour later, he called me out and said, you have to go home, you're expelled. So I got expelled on my first day. Anyway, my dad had to go back and make a peace pact and beg them to keep me on a trial basis. Anyway, in other words, I wasn't a very good student. So that's my South African world. I had the mountains behind me. I had the sea and the surf and the white sands in front of me. We were free to walk and drive, with our bikes. We used to bike all over the Cape Point. I had a lovely life, surfing, lots of young girls, bikinis. It was a wonderful time. I had a wonderful life. I should have been absolutely a lovely young man, but I really, really wasn't. So when my father died, he was 52 years of age, and I was about 17 or so. The first thing I did was, I'm getting out of here. I want to go to London, because I had a taste of London when I went on a European holiday with my family years before. I said, I want the big time. I don't want this little South Africa stuff. I want to get back to London. So I went, got on the plane, and didn't know anybody except one person who I knew. And I called him, and he said, oh, yeah, good you're back. And he said, come, you can stay with me. And he lived in Guildford. And that's where I moved in, and just started to gradually get towards the West End. I'm going to stop soon on this part of it, because it goes on when I get into America. But this part is important, because I gravitated to the West End, and I graduated to Soho, and I end up running two porno stores on Berwick Street. I was the youngest pornographer in London. And I started earning a lot of money. And with the money came the clothes, came the cars, came the jewelry, came the girls. I had a white E-type Jag, you know, white E-type Jag. 2 plus 2 is must be, you have to pay about 80, I don't know how much. It could be half a million. They are so rare today, but they were top car. I'd drive around. Then I had another car called a Cadillac convertible, and it was black, I mean red with white interior. And that's how I used to drive up to the nightclubs in one of these cars, and everyone got to know me, and I had money, rolls of it, no credit cards in those days, I had cash. And I'd go into the bar and I'd buy champagne for everybody. I'd just walk in, people come around me, Dom Perignon all around, you know. So I was competing with the rock stars, money-wise. And they all would go to these clubs. I knew, I got to know a lot of them. And they got to know me, in a sense. But I got to know this world, this corrupt world, because it was very corrupt. Now it's corrupt today. It was corrupt then as well. In those days, it was there wasn't the mafia per se, because the police basically ran the show. And you pay the top police, and you have to be introduced, of course, but you pay the vice squad, and they would allow you to have a license to open up a porno store or a strip club or gambling, whatever. And so this is how I lived. I got to know all the local Soho hookers and all the crooks, and there's many of them. And I got to know this world. Well, what I'll stop soon, because I've been talking for more than, because you know, we weren't live at that time.
Well, why don't we pause there, and I'm going to play one of your songs, Michael.
Okay, let me just finish this part.
Then you can go and get some water.
No, I'm going to finish this last bit.
All right.
Okay, because it's important. Okay, because that. Okay, now, so now, because I was very flash, I lived in the water gardens, a big luxury apartment blocks that went up, block of flats in Park Lane. And I got a phone call from the other police station, who I'd paid them, as well as the other big one, you know, the Scotland Yard one. And he said, "Michael, you, I want to let you know that you're under 24-hour observation, and I would suggest you take a holiday." So with that advice, because now I had a gambling club in my home where I lived, in the Water Gardens, I turned it with poker tables, blackjack, bunny girls, bath filled with champagne, and overlooked the Victoria Sporting Club, where I could watch all the rich Arabs that were just coming in the 60s with bags of money, and they used to gamble, and I used to watch them pull out this money from my flat. And so the price of rents went up because the Arabs came in. So meanwhile, I said, "Oh my God, I've got to get out of here." So I decided I'm going to go take a trip to America, to Los Angeles. And I will tell you about that trip next time, because that leads me into the good part, which you want to hear. This stuff you just got to get out the way, when I actually did have a meeting with Jesus. So God bless you.
All right, you're not going. I'm not letting you go yet. I'm going to play a song, and then we'll get up to the bit with Jesus.
Answer me, O Lord above. Just what sin have I been guilty of? Tell me how I came to lose my love. Please answer me, oh Lord. She was mine yesterday. I believe that love was here to stay. Won't you tell me where I went astray? Please answer me, oh Lord. If she's happier without me, don't tell her I care. But if she still thinks about me, please let her hear my prayer. Let her know I've been true. Send her back so we can start anew. In my sorrow now I turn to you. Please answer me, oh Lord. Happier without me, don't tell her I care. But if she still thinks about me, please let her hear my prayer. Let her know I've been true. Send her back so we can start anew. In my sorrow, may I turn to you. Please answer me, oh Lord. Answer me, oh Lord.
So we'll get to that in another program, the music side. But I've put it along the bottom of the screen. If anybody wants to access any more of your music, that's a good place to go to get it. But we left you just as you were moving or going to LA. But you were only going to LA for a short time originally, weren't you? Just going for a holiday.
I was going for 9 days, yeah, just to get out of the heat.
Yeah. I stayed
9 years without a visa.
So you got to LA and did everything change? I mean, when you got to LA, did you suddenly become a good boy? Or
No, I was a bad boy, but let me put on the light because suddenly it's got dark in here.
Okay. Yeah, I got my lights on already because I know what it's like. So that's better. I've got used to that, so I put my blinds down and put my lights on because otherwise I know I'm going to be in the dark. Yeah. Last week I had a guest here actually in my studio and I didn't have the big light on because, you know, I have the little light on there and it got dark and dark when he couldn't read his Bible. He couldn't read his notes. And he was sitting right here. And I couldn't get past him to go turn the light on. So he just, I love your story, Michael. I love the fact, I mean, you know, you skimmed over some of your stuff in London, but weren't you passing fake money at some point that you had to, one of the reasons why you had to get out of the way? You were a bit flash with the dodgy dollars or whatever.
I was involved in the porno vice, in the gambling, illegal gambling clubs. Then I did a lot of counterfeit dollars.
So
and that got me in big trouble with the Secret Service in America.
Yeah. So you weren't the kind of boy that mummy would have wanted people to take home.
know, they're horrified.
So you get to LA and you know nobody in LA, you're just there on holiday. So how did you get from there, 9 days holiday, to staying and sustaining yourself for 9 years? Because you had no visa, presumably.
Yeah, but I didn't think about things like that, you know. I just went, and it was 1971, I remember. And got on a plane, and I had suitcases, two suitcases packed with the London shoes at that time, because someone told me that I really love it in LA. So I had bags of these that I got from the High Street Kensington Market, and I had a lot of gold in case I needed to pawn it if I ran out of money. Again, you can remember this is 71. It's not like you can, you know, no credit cards and or cash, you know. And you know, even to make a phone call cost you a lot of money. So it was different, a different world. But I arrived, and someone I met on the plane or the airport, I can't remember, asked me where I was going. I said, well, I'm going to Los Angeles. He said, well, I'm going there. I'll give you a lift, drop you off. He said, where do you want to go? I said, oh, the only place I knew was Sunset Boulevard. So I said, Sunset Boulevard. And so he drove, and he said, well, anywhere? I said, well, the hotel. And there was the, oh, so he drove to the hotel there. And I checked in, and that was it. Checked in my suitcase. I didn't know anybody at all. But the first night I met somebody at the bar, you know, a young lady, and she swapped numbers. And that's how I gradually got to know her and then her friends. And you know how it goes. But then I also checked over. I got out of that hotel, was a 5-star, and I went into a cheaper hotel that had a front entrance and a back entrance, which I needed because one of the girlfriends I had, you know, this is 60s hookers, you know, these are bad, bad girls. And this one girl, she loved me to bits and gave me as much as I want money-wise, and she gave me gold, jewelry, whatnot. And I just told her I was going for 9 days. Well, I didn't come back, so she, guess what? She actually caught a plane over to find me and tracked me down at the Sunset Boulevard. I don't know how she found out, but anyway, I remember saying to the bellboy there, I said, listen, if there's some English girl asking for me, she's a crazy lady, you've got to call me immediately and let me know that she's here, because I had a feeling that she's going to try and find where I am. So anyway, the room I had was there was a pool, and so there was the hotel room had a front door, and it had another escape door, which I called it the back door to the pool. And sure enough, I get the phone call. Oh, there's a lady here asking for you. She's English. I just let you know she's coming down. I went, oh, she would have must have had a knife or something. You know, I'd taken. Taken her money and taken all of her jewelry that she gave me to keep and everything else. And so she was kind of, I got out the back door, and that was it. She came, couldn't find me. And thank God that was over. But I lived the crazy life. It was all crazy. Now the LA story, though, is good because this is what God had arranged to get me to a place where I could hear the gospel. I wouldn't have heard the gospel in Soho in the 60s. And there wasn't any television. There was no me. I would never have gone to a church. You wouldn't, you know, if you're going to get someone like me, you're going to have a special hook with some special bait. And God had that already arranged to hook me. And that's what I can share next time, is how I got hooked to...
I don't think you can leave it there, Michael. We've got so much more to talk about next time. You can't leave it there. So you're in LA. You carried on with the gambling. You didn't have porno stores, but you carried on with the gambling. You were dating movie stars that people would know the name of. You were living the high life.
I was living the high life, but again, that was London was the high life. When I got to LA, I had to live off the the shoes I bought. They love those shoes, Americans. And I said,
but then you were gambling.
Was it not? Because it was English. Anything English in LA in those days, oh, you know, because English was, we were the cool guys, you know.
Right.
But this shifted over to in the 70s, it was all about LA. 60s was all about London, you know, the Beatles and all the music from the English music and everything else. But as an Englishman in LA, and just for that one thing, that I had an accent, people would always want to know me and to get around me, and I was interesting, you see, because there weren't too many of us. And that's how I got to know people. That's how I met people. And that's eventually I ended up, yes, my girlfriend was Victoria Principal, I tell you, you know, from the young, from
Dallas.
Dallas, yeah. But she was a young starlet at that time, and she'd done her first movie, but everyone was, you know, realizing she's going to be a big actress. And so I dated her for about 6 months. And I remember one, now I'm living in LA now, I'm knowing people, I'm meeting people, and I've got a flat in Kings Road in Los Angeles. And I was going to experience something. God had already planned my time to get hooked. Like I said, he had a hook and he has a special bait on it, and he got me. But before that moment of being hooked while watching a television show called The Amazing Prophecy, which I came across by accident, well, it wasn't an accident, God planned it, and a preacher was I never heard a preacher preach, and he was talking about Jesus. But before that, I remember weeks before that, something strange was happening to me. And it was like, you know, because I spent a lot of time in the flat, and I'd watch movies and da da da, you know. And then suddenly I'm watching things like Little Orphan Annie and movies about Lassie the dog, stuff that, you know, I would never watch in a million years. I have no interest in that. But somehow my heart was getting softened with these stories and Disney movies, you know. And I'm saying to myself, what's going on? Why am I feeling a bit weepy here? And I remember there was a moment where I actually slapped myself and said, wake up, Bassett. You know, it's a hard world out there. You can't become soppy with all this, watching all this stuff. But what God was doing through the entertainment was softening my heart. He was getting me ready to hear the gospel. So you can't really hear the gospel if your heart is hard. You've got to be softened. God's got to soften you up somehow. And he has ways and means of doing that. With mine, it was through entertainment. Can you believe it? Hollywood, Disney movies. And so now I'm about to walk out the door. I'm all dressed up, ready to go out you know, do the scene. I was well known in the local area of Beverly Hills and the nightclubs and the backgammon clubs. I was a very big and very good backgammon player. And I'd gamble in this club, and I said, should I go there? I want to meet someone, tell me about Jesus. Because what happened is the preacher started preaching, and he said, when Jesus Christ died on the cross, something like 33 prophecies were instantly fulfilled from Psalms 22. Now, I don't know what Psalms 22 is, what he's talking about. But then he said this. He said, this is not a 100-to-1 shot that Christ would come back, one of the promises in the Bible. But when he said 100-to-1, he said, that was my hook, because I was a gambler. And so 100-to-1, I'm hearing about odds here. And he said, no, it's not 500 or 1,000-to-1. He said, this is because of the law of probability of 22 out of the book of Psalms 22, 33 prophecies were instantly fulfilled on the cross. He said the law of compound probability would kick in and say it's an absolute certain that Christ would come back, because that's one of the remaining prophecies. And when I heard that, then he said, are you ready to receive Christ? And I went, no. I remember him saying, well, if you're a sinner, and I went, yes. You know, I had no problem with being a sinner. I was a good sinner. I knew it. And he said, well, get down on your knees and say this prayer. Well, then I said the sinner's prayer. So I'm saying the sinner's prayer. And I felt, you know, that something's happening to me. What am I doing? I was only going out to a nightclub. Now I'm on my knees and saying these words. And I thought, well, I better find out what I just did. So when the program stopped, I was there left in this flat by myself, ready to go out. So I said, well, I'm going to go out. Where should I go? Should I go to the Backgammon Club? Or should I go to a candy store in Rodeo Drive, Beverly Hills, and find out about Jesus? I've got to find out. Someone can tell me about Jesus. Well, you see, can you imagine my mind? Most people would say, well, maybe Sunday I'll ask the pastor about Jesus. Or I'll go to the church and meet some people, and they can tell me about it. I didn't think about church. I didn't think about, I didn't know nothing about this. My parents never took me to church. We never prayed. We never did anything. My parents didn't know the Lord and didn't know anything about Bible stories or anything else. So anyway, I go out, get in my car, drive to the candy store, private club. You go knock on the door, and I go in, and they know me, of course. And I go up to the bar, and I'm just sitting there on the stool, looking around at what's going on. And then some acquaintance I know from the club said to me, hey, you want me to buy you a drink? I said, no, I'm fine. Then someone else came up to me and said, hey, Mike, you want a little stuff up your nose? You know, I've got a few lines. We can do it in the men's room there. I said, no, I don't want any drugs. I have a mission. I'm going to find Jesus. Well, it's stupid, isn't it? But God's got a sense of humor. I remember looking around the room, and there was one girl, blonde girl, very good looking girl, and she was sitting there by herself. So I walked over to her and I said, excuse me. I said, but do you know anything about Jesus? Just popped out. And the music stopped, I think, at that time. People looking around, what's he saying? And so she looked at me, and I could tell her thinking, you know, she was saying to herself, my goodness, that's a good line. Never heard that one before. Now, she was a Hollywood starlet. She acted in The Young and the Restless, a TV series. And so she said to me, she said, well, actually, she says, someone's asked me to come to a Bible study in a place called Bellflower, you know, East LA. I said, where's that? She said, oh, I don't know even, because this is all Beverly Hills, you know, West LA. So she said, but I was invited. I don't know if I'm going to go. And I said, listen, give me your phone number, and I'll call you. We'll make a date to go there together. So she gave me a phone number. So I had my connection. Yeah, I was going to find about Jesus. And God met me in the nightclub with this good looking actress. So I remember, it was Friday, so I remember calling her Thursday, and I said, listen, I said, what are we going to wear? We're going to meet all these holy people. And so she said, I don't know, I've never been to anything like this. I said, well, I suggest that we wear white. I think we should do that. So she said, that's a good idea. So now remember, I'm in LA now, I'm in the sunshine, my hair now is, I had a lot of hair, and it was all streaked along, my teeth were white, I looked good, you know, plus I'm wearing the shoes that I brought over, and some of these were the Corkies, you know, the 6-inch heels, and I'm nearly 6'1", and with my heels I'm 6'7", so all in white hair, you know, blonde hair streak, and she drives up in a white, a white convertible, American, I forgot which one it was now, very flash, you know, convertible white, I can't think of the name, it'll come to me. So I get in the car, and she said, well, we've got to go now to, no sand map, you know, to the 71, so we got a map. And she said, look, will you help me navigate to the house? So after a while, we arrive, and she parked outside. It was a very you know, humble area in the Beverly Hills here. We're very humble. And I said, you wait there, I'm going to go knock on the door. And so I went in and knocked on the door. Now remember, I'm now 6'1". All in white.
6'7" even. 6'7"
even. All in white. As you opened the door, I went, woo! I saw an angel had turned up at the door. All sat there. And I said, hold on a second. I said, I want to come in to this Bible study, but I've got my friend out there. And then she gets out of this white convertible, all in white, with her corkies on. And we had to, we said to each other, when we go and we'll be wallflowers, we won't say a thing, we'll just listen. Because that would be a wallflower. Everyone's looking at others, pointing at them, coming up to, who are you? And so we've come out of Hollywood, you know, this is Hollywood stuff. And now this is East LA stuff. So anyway, we listened to what it was and we left. And she said, I don't want to go back there. I said, fine. But I wanted to go back. See, God started a hunger in me. So for the next 6 weeks or so, I would go back every week. Should we stop there?
That's a good place to stop, yeah. So, because now, when we meet again, then you'll continue with your LA story, so that, and then we can come over to when you came back to UK, because, you know, that it starts getting, God starts really moving.
These are all chapters, yes.
They're absolutely. They're amazing chapters. And so I'm gonna play another one of your songs, Mike. I've got a clip I'm going to save for the next time. But what I'm going to do is, you've already mentioned you're 80 and you had an 80th birthday party in Tottenham.
Yeah.
Hosted at the Town Hall in London by some of us that were staff with you.
Yeah.
And we got you up to sing this, so I'm going to show that.
Okay.
Why me, Lord? Have I ever done to deserve even one of the pleasure I've known? Tell me, Lord, what did I ever do that was worth loving you for the kindness you've shown? Lord, help me, Jesus, I've wasted it, so help me, Jesus, I know what I am. Now that I know that I needed you, so help me, Jesus, my soul's in think there's a way where I can repay all I've taken from you. Show me, Lord, if I can help someone else with what I've been through myself on my way back to you. Lord, help me, Jesus, I've wasted it, so help me, Jesus, I know what I am. Now that I know that I needed you, so help me, Jesus, my soul's in your hands. Lord, help
A great night, wasn't it?
It was very good. I very appreciate it too, of all of you getting together.
It was just lovely. It was lovely to see you and Denise and the family. And yeah. We'll learn about all of those. But, you know, the history, people don't realize, Michael, that, you know, we've gone back to your beginnings, which, you know, is great because that's how I know that because of the way you got saved, you had a real heart for TV, for Christian television, for ministering through the screen, because you know how valuable that is and how, you know, there's no other way that you can reach so many people and with those little hooks. And so, you know, that's really important to know that. But, you know, what people don't realize is that you pioneered. You're a pioneer. I mean, there's no two ways about it. You're a pioneer. You're pioneering this nation, and you've got. There are many thousands of people that have you to thank for their foundation in the things of God. I mean, you know, Word of Faith came into this country through you. And most people don't realize that. And now people are, well, actually years later, people were preaching faith and bringing faith ministers in from America as if it was a brand new thing. And you'd been preaching it for years. You know, you were always ahead of your time, which is why you always got in trouble, because you were always way ahead of where everyone else was. You were preaching what people are preaching now. You were preaching 20 odd years ago. And I always laugh because, you know, I remember some of the stuff that you got thrown at you because of your stand on the Word of God, because of faith, because of grace, and, you know, high profile ministers that just came against you because you were preaching. And those same ministers are preaching the same thing now because, you know, it's like they're caught up. And, you know, I don't know what it is, but I know that God has always used you because you're bold. And I guess that's your background has enabled you to have a boldness to just be out there, you know. Would you say that's fair?
So, well, I think that I don't have a religious bone in my body, basically. I don't have religion. I wasn't raised in any form of religion. So to me, it was all new. It was all wonderful. And I fell in love with Jesus. And I've had experiences in that realm of the spirit. And people ask me, because we did have a large church at that time. You know, I remember Sunday morning, we definitely had 1,000 people. One time we could count them even. Well, that small little church there on Finchley Road. But people have asked me, you know, well, how do you build churches? And God's honest truth, I said, I didn't. I didn't do anything. I just turned up and God did it all. I don't take any glory at all from this. It's all God. God did it supernaturally. And yes, it did. It did affect London. It did affect different parts of the world, especially with the Bible school, you know, which Hampstead Bible School. We had students from all over the earth. You know, so they took it all back and, so I give God the glory. I didn't do anything. I didn't have the skills, Jen. I had no theological training. I'd never been to anything. I just read the Bible and that's it. I got ordained. I got ordained in Tulsa, Oklahoma. Larry Huggins was the associate pastor. Buddy Harrison was a senior pastor, and he was the son-in-law of Kenneth Hagin. And so I had the privilege of meeting Kenneth Hagin in London, in Dorchester. We had tea together, which was nice. But, you know, these are all the Word of Faith people.
Yeah.
And I love the Word of Faith. Again, it's not perfect. None of it's perfect. I don't care. You name a denomination, you name anybody. As soon as you put people in there, there's problems. But we did have, we stood on the Word of God. That's all I remember.
We
stood on the Word of God, and I preached Jesus. That's all I knew to preach.
Yeah.
And we taught faith. And then, of course, we got accused of being prosperity preachers and whatnot. But, you know, I heard what I heard in the Bible, and I believed it. So maybe that's why I was the richest preacher in London.
But, you know, I remember that. I remember that question being posed at you and your answer. And, you know, over the years, I have experienced some just little nuggets of wisdom. I was talking about you the other day to someone, and I said, and you probably don't remember this, but years ago there was a lady who was preaching about redeeming the land, and I wasn't comfortable with it at all, and some friends of mine had got involved in it, and I remember coming to Hampstead, and you and I went just down the road for a coffee. We were just sitting at this little cafe just down the road from on Finchley Road. And I told you about it. And I remember you going, God's into redeeming people, not real estate. And, you know, that was just like that little nugget of wisdom. And I never forgot it because God has always used you like that. Just cut right to the chase. And so I do appreciate that. And I really appreciate you coming on, Michael, because, you know, and you know, I told you we're going to have you on again. I already said we need to establish a date before we leave here today. We're going to establish a date. But guys, I know that we've gone over our allotted time because I started late. My fault entirely. But I'm going to just finish off by running you the Bible College ad. So to remind you, Michael started Hampstead Bible School. I took over as the principal, and we became a college, an accredited college, and now it has become Real Life Bible College Online. So I'm going to most definitely roll out with that. But I do want to talk about so many other things. There's so many things that we've got to say, and you know, Michael is going to come back and tell us about it. So, Michael, before I run the Bible College ad, would you just pray for everyone?
Sure. Okay. Heavenly Father, we thank you for your mercies, your goodness, your grace, the abilities for us to minister the glory of God over the technology that you've given the earth. And if we use it right, we'll be blessed and we'll be a blessing. And we're using the technology now for the glory of God, to the glory of God, lifting up Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior. And I thank you, Lord God, for this new work, Just One Word, and also the life, what's it, New Life, you're calling it? College, Jan?
Real life.
We lift that real life because we want real life. We don't want fakey stuff. We want the real thing, and the real thing is Jesus.
Amen.
And I thank you, Lord God, that the real life college will increase by the increase of God, like you did with me in the beginning. People just kept coming. Just like in the book of Acts, you added thousands to the church in one day. Lord, you add the people, the students, you make them hungry to be able to, I don't know, shortcut to truth, because Amen. You spend donkey's years, you can spend 20 years not knowing certain little things that set you free. And I thank you, Lord God, for the teaching ability in Jan, that gift that you've given her. And I thank you for all the other people that will come on board. And we call it blessed, blessed, blessed. In Jesus' name, amen and amen.
Amen. So God bless you, everyone. Watch the ad and, sign up. Do you want to know how to study the Bible and get the best out of what you read? Do you want to understand scriptures in a way you never have before? Are you hungry to learn about the things of God? Do you want to take a deeper dive into the Word? I want to know more about the Lord and His will for my life. And at the beginning, church and Bible study seemed to be enough. And I tried to study alone, but it only took me so far. I would envy how others seem to have the ability to understand and draw more out of the Bible. Then I realized that Bible college would give me the depth of understanding that I couldn't get in any other way, the breadth of knowledge that I was looking for. Being able to study the Word in a systematic way really helped me to understand what God was saying to me, as well as learning how to study, which is an important thing. A lot of times I would just look in the Bible and read it and not really understand how to get the best out of it. So I was able to develop through that. I was able to develop into the minister that I am today. In Real Life Bible College, you will learn what the Bible means. You'll be challenged by the Word, and most definitely you'll be changed from glory to glory. You'll learn how to practically renew your mind in a scriptural way. You'll learn how to walk in the authority that we have in Christ. You'll learn how to develop unshakable faith and how to walk in the healing that God has paid for us at Calvary in Jesus. And much, much more. These classes are suited to the newest Christian, to the aspiring minister, and to the seasoned minister. So check out the link and see what Real Life Bible College has to offer you now. So, okay, guys, have an awesome week, and don't forget to check out the link, reallifebiblecollege.com, and I will see you at, in fact, there you go, look, I've put it up there, reallifebiblecollege.com. Don't forget the two L's, real life, and I'll see you at 4 o'clock next Wednesday with my guest is Emmanuel King, Reverend Emmanuel King, who is the head of Prison Outreach Network. So don't miss that one. You have an awesome week. God bless you, and I'll see you then. Bye.